amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are
all alike began to make excuses. The first said, "I have just bought a field and I must go and see it. Please excuse me." Another said, "I have just bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm on my way to try them out. Please excuse me." Still another said, "I just got married, so I can't come." The servant came back and reported this to his master. Then the owner of the house became angry and ordered his servant, "Go out quickly into the streets and alleys of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame." "Sir," the servant said, "what you ordered has been done, but there is still room." Then the master told his servant, "Go out to the roads and country lanes and compel them to come in, so that my house will be full. I tell you, not one of those who were invited will get a taste of my banquets."
No, I'm tall, but I'm not quite that tall. Okay, quite often when we have these celebrations and we have these different festivals, now just raise your hands, just show of hands of who likes festivals and celebrations. Fun times, yeah. And we've got some palm branches as well that's being waved as well, thank you. Okay, we get dressed up and we look forward to having that celebration, to meeting people that we haven't maybe seen in a long time, to catching up and getting to know each other. And as we heard earlier on, the Jewish festival of Passover, it was a family event. It was a family time where they got together. They got to catch up on all the different stuff that had been going on. When Jesus celebrated the Passover with his disciples, he was basically saying to them, remember the significance of this. Because this is monumental. God, the sovereign God, the creator of the universe, has rescued the people out of slavery and out of all these difficulties that they've gone through. And this is, I guess it's really key, but I'll get to that in a second. Jesus told his disciples that he would not eat the meal again, the Passover meal again, until he returned, until everything in the kingdom of God that had been promised had come to fruition and it was done. This tells us two things. One, that he's coming back, and two, that he will eat with us again. Now, you say, well, I don't know about all that stuff. Well, that's fine. That's your privilege. It doesn't change the fact. When God has made a commitment and he's made a promise and he said, this is the way it is, it's a done deal. If God is saying yes, and you can look through the Old Testament, the New Testament, and still what he's doing today, and you can hear him saying, look, I promise you this, it's a done deal. He will fulfill it, no matter what it is, no matter what it is. But this is a point that I want to throw out there. There was all these different excuses, people that made these promises to come and then didn't come along. I have a question for you. If Jesus was to invite you to this party and to this celebration, would you know him? Would you be able to go up to him and say, my Lord, my Savior, the Sovereign, down on your knees and worship him for who he is, for Holy Almighty God? Or would you say, well, I think I know you from somewhere. Your face looks kind of familiar to me. The reason I bring this up is because from a personal story which I've had this week, I had someone come up to me and say, oh yeah, I know all about you, you're John Morris, you're this artist and this, that and the other. And if you're anything like me, when you see someone that you think, I know you from somewhere, but I really can't process where I know you from. So my mind then stops from thinking, okay, if you listen long enough, you may find out who this person is, to who on earth are you? I don't recognize you. I know you know all about me, but I don't know anything about you. It's one of the things that freaks me out the most, I have to be honest with that. The fact is, when God made this promise and he said, or when Jesus made this promise and he said, I am coming back. If this was a TV show, you'd probably hear the theme from Coronation Street. Na, 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 na. And then up would rise the credits and everything else. But the thing is, this is real life. God has made that promise and he said, I will fulfill it. It will happen. But sometimes we're not very good at remembering these things. And that happens to every one of us, to myself who's just starting out in ministry, to some of the older retired ministers. We remember that God has told us something, but then during the difficult times, it can become very scary. It can become frightening, and we forget God's promises a lot of the time. In some ways, and I honestly, history has a habit of repeating itself. No matter what it is, and I always say this, the clothes change, but the scenarios stay the same. Because you can look through the Old Testament, the New Testament, you can look through any time period in history, and it's very, very similar. Okay, you've had wars, you've had famines, you've had poverty, you've had riches, on and on and on and on and on. And it always happens. And today, we're not that much different from the time of Jerusalem. I'm just going to pick up on some things here. Jesus was there for a family get-together with his disciples. A time to remember when God had saved his people from slavery, from terrible beatings, from oppression and everything else. But what did Jesus find? A city that was more interested in the financial side of things, money, the politics, how this looked. What would this do for us? What would it do for me? As I say, history repeats itself. Because quite honestly, sometimes we go to parties with ulterior motives. Another question for you. If someone had sent you an invitation, or if you'd sent an invitation out to someone, you'd spent so many hours and so many months planning this party and this festival, and no one turned up, how would you feel? If you're me, I would feel pretty hurt and pretty upset. In what we've just heard, it's no different. God invites people to this banquet, and all these different excuses start to come out. I'm going to buy, or I've just bought a field, and I'm going to go check it out. I've just got all this oxen and everything else, and I'm going to go check them out now. If you're anything like me, as a businessman, honestly and truthfully, I would not invest my money in something that I have not already seen. It's a bad investment. It's a bad investment of my time, of my money, and everything else. But it's good. It's a decent excuse, you know, really. And then the third one, which kind of made me chuckle as well. I've just got married, and I'm kind of under the thumb. I've no social life anymore. I heard some titters from over this side. And again, that was the excuse. We've just got married, and we've no time for a party. We've no time for any celebration or anything else. All these excuses, and they get worse and worse each and every time. Are we any different sometimes when God calls us? God, I would like to do these things, but no. God, I really want to help that person, but I've just got something I would rather do. I've another priority. No. Eventually, God just, you honestly hear him a lot of the time saying, you know. Are you actually going to do what I've called you to do, or do we have to go round this mountain time and time again until you finally say, right, God, I will do what you want me to do? So I want to leave you with two things. The kingdom of heaven is often referred to as a banquet, an amazing party. Now, given the fact that God is the sovereign of the universe, he's the creator of all things, and he wants the absolute best for his children and for his people, can you imagine what this party would be like with him? And yet when he says, here's the invitation for you, I say, oh, no, no, God, I don't want that. I've something better to do. Who in the mind would turn around and say, God, I don't want to come to this party? Because it's beyond our comprehension, this party of what God has in store for us. When you meet Jesus, one day we all will, are you going to know him? Are you going to recognize him for who he is? Or are you going to do what I do with some people when they come up to me, as I said, and, well, I think I know you, sir. I spent some time and then hearing about you, but I'm not overly certain I know you, Lord. Or are you going to be able to say, yes, Jesus, I want to go to this party. You know, when does it begin? When does it start? Some of you in the congregation today might even be saying, I'm not even a Christian. How does any of that work for me? It doesn't. What can I do to get my invite to this party? Simple. Confess your sin before God. Say, Lord, I've made a mess of my life. Or even if you're at the other side of the spectrum where you're saying, God, I've been blessed with all the riches. I've been blessed with a wife, husband, with children, with houses, with fame, fortune, everything else. But there's still something missing in my life. There's still something I'm yearning for. And maybe this crazy long-haired guy at the front, maybe there's just something there. God, if it is, I want to know, and I want to know you. And when you say that, will he turn you away if you say that? No. He will say, my son, my daughter, come. Come to the party. And I challenge you today, if there is any legitimate reason why you wouldn't do that or why you wouldn't want to do that, that's between you and the Lord. But as far as I know, there's no legitimate reasons to say no to God, because he wants the absolute best for you. Let's pray together. And Father God, how eternally thankful we are for your amazing love, your amazing grace upon us. That you love us just as we are and not as we should be. That you are willing to take the most difficult and hurting of lives and even the best of everything, Lord. And you're willing to say, I still want this. I still want you. I still love you. And you are still my child. No matter what it is, you are my child and I seal you. Lord, would you sink this message so deep within the hearts of every single person that hears this, that it cannot be lost? And would you bless us afresh with your spirit and with your love, we pray. In Jesus' mighty, holy, powerful, and precious name, amen.